when people learn about slavery, when they learn about the oppression that black people have faced and continue to face, they also realize that they have the power to survive it. We have survived it. The black race has not disappeared as people predicted, and we continue to draw strength from the power of the survival of our ancestors.
California Bound, Slavery on the New Frontier, 1848 to 1865 is an exhibition that provides a historical overview of California's involvement with enslavement in the 19th century. We used 7 physical lenders who were comprised of archives and collectors. We also worked very tediously with a scholar by the name of Dr. Stacy L. Smith, whose work, Freedom Frontier, was able to undergird our research and provide more historical context for this exhibition. And all of those things helped us to populate this room and also give a new take and a new thesis on California's involvement with enslavement. Within this exhibition, we go from 1537 all the way down to 1865, but we wanted to find the direct key points that really support why California's involvement with enslavement was so significant.
California's role in slavery has gone completely not recognized. Because of the Compromise of 1850, in which California was brought into the Union as a free state, people just assumed that there was never slavery here. But indeed, there was slavery of indigenous people and slavery of people of African descent as well.
When California decided that it wanted to become a state, it petitioned to enter into the Union as a free state. At the time, the United States Congress really wanted to focus on the Missouri Compromise, which happened in 1820, to really try to keep an even balance between free states and slave states. With California entering into the Union, potentially as a free state at that moment, it definitely shifted the balance in this power struggle. So at that time, Whig Senator Henry Clay from Kentucky and Democratic Senator Stephen Douglas from Illinois got together and formed the Compromise of 1850. And within this compromise, it really consisted of 5 key points: that Texas would surrender its claim to the New Mexico Territory, that Washington, D.C. would no longer dabble in the slave trade, however, slavery was still there, that the new territories could decide for themselves whether they wanted to be a free state or a slave state, that California would enter into the Union as a free state, and the 5th point was, of course, a stricter fugitive slave law that impacted the nation.
Well, the fugitive slave law was, coming out of the Compromise of 1850, was a devastating federal legislation with regard to African Americans. The fugitive slave law allowed, really, African Americans to be thrown back into slavery with very little evidence that they indeed were enslaved peoples. With that, those persons who were quote-unquote free at the time had a very dangerous threat hanging over their heads. And we could see it in, you know, hundreds of, if not thousands, of free blacks being kidnapped and sold into slavery under the, you know, deception that indeed they had escaped, because there was very little evidence to come to bear to prove that you were free. People therefore began to move to Canada. People began to move to the far west, California, for example, to escape the impact of the law, so that, you know, if slavery is not so prominent a place as it was not so prominent in California, they could think of living their lives truly as free people.
California Democrats came together to try to figure out, what are we going to do with this large amount of people, of enslaved Africans who came to California while it was a territory between 1848 up until statehood in September 1850. So one of the things that they decided to do was come up with their own fugitive slave law, known as the Fugitive Slave Law of 1852. This one included a sunset clause that gave enslavers 1 year to collect their enslaved Africans in California. However, we see in our research that California Democrats really extended this until 1855. This law definitely contradicts the idea of California being a freedom frontier, mainly because, again, of the sunset clause. When we're thinking about California being a free state during this time period, it really was just a declaration of principle. Once the 13th Amendment was really ratified, those African American citizens who were once enslaved really found power and upliftment with becoming full citizens. And the 13th Amendment only really marked the first of three Reconstruction Amendments. The first was the 13th Amendment, which abolished slavery. The 14th Amendment, which gave citizenship. And the 15th Amendment, which gave voting rights. However, it's interesting to see that though California again entered into the Union as a free state, it only ratified the 13th Amendment, ratifying the 14th Amendment in 1959 and the 15th Amendment in 1962. With California not ratifying the 14th and 15th Amendment until the 1960s, it really meant that minorities did not receive full citizenship and those types of benefits that come with that.
Certainly our history of oppression within this country has lingering psychological impact. The belief and the understanding that Black people have never been equal under the law, regardless of what the 14th Amendment says to us, no matter what the various local laws or state laws or federal or court decisions are.
While the History Department was researching this information and putting together this exhibition, we really wanted to have a place for reflection where people could leave messages and notes. And from us being able to look back to see what people wrote, we can see that the visitors who came to this exhibition already have learned so much, something new that they'll be able to pass on to their friends, their family, in order to really create this dialogue and this conversation about enslavement. And being able to bring it forward into the present to really see how the time periods really overlap between 1850 and 2018.